Okay, thank you. Yes, as you said, I'm a project manager at Bulatos, and I'm coordinating the third phase of Mont Blanc project. And my topic today is to show you the work being done, undertaken, and to be continued on this Mont Blanc project, which is, I think, a very good example of what we can do in Europe right now. And it's really related to the work that has been presented previously by our Chinese and Japanese colleagues. You may see many common points. So my plan is quite simple. First, have a look at the past, the history of the project. Then look at the present work and terminate with concluding remarks on what can be done in the future. So the Mont Blanc project was initiated more than 5 years ago now, with the idea to leverage on the fast-growing market of mobile technology for scientific computation. You have here all the partners that did participate all together to the project. The first phase of the project, which was called Mont Blanc, was really the proof of concept of doing HPC computation with some mobile embedded technology. And it was really a proof of concept. It showed that it works, and it was something quite important. And now we can talk about really using ARM technology for HPC, and this is for a real part due to this initial work. Mont Blanc 2 was a kind of continuation, extending the concept and working on new possibilities, extending also the software side of the project. And now we are in Mont Blanc 3, with the aim to prepare an industrial solution and also to test the market acceptance of these technologies. So, as I already mentioned, the initial motivation was to use technology developed for mobile devices, which is very low power, with a very low cost also chips, and which is targeting mass number. The mass number permit to anticipate and expect some nice improvement of performances through the years. And also, so we all together can expect a nice performance per power, so energy efficiency, and a nice performance per dollar, a nice economical efficiency. But of course, those ships did have many missing features, lack of software, poor network interfaces. There's no infinite band on those ships, of course, and rather poor error correction features. So the work done did demonstrate that parallel system software could be running on a cluster composed with such components, and that application could scale up also on those systems. We did produce a set of prototypes during the run of this project. So at the beginning, prototypes were deployed in the frame of PRACE funding. We also had some mini clusters deployed by the initial phase of Mont Blanc. And then a rather huge prototype have been developed by Bull, with, I will give a little more details in the next slide. But this prototype was really a good test bed to show that real application, real HPC application, could run on this mobile aimed technology. And we are continuing with some ARM 64-bit mini clusters being deployed currently. So the Mont Blanc prototype that has been shown in the previous slide is composed with an Exynos 5 compute card. So it's a credit bank card form factor. It has a SoC dual core plus a GPU, 4 GB of RAM, local storage with a micro SD, and a network bridging with an USB two-way Ethernet bridge, and also some power management features. So those cards were put on blades. We can put up to 15 compute cards on a blade. The blades are put in chassis, and the chassis all together are installed in a rack that is currently installed in Barcelona in BSC's chapel, if you know their data center in Barcelona. So this prototype really did permit to run some consequent application, even on this rather, I would say, poor technology if we compare to HPC CPUs that can be found today, and did permit to do some quite interesting research work on how to go further based on this technology. So a look on the work that has been done at this time, based, for instance, on this the test prototype. The work has been done on the application-based fault tolerance with the idea to enable the application to overcome some failure because such systems were much more likely than a standard HPC system to meet some failures. So work has been done on several levels. With at system level, I would say a fine-grained task-based checkpointing done by the runtime with FTI and permitting some error recovery later. And on the upper side, an application-based fault tolerance with error detection and the possibility to come back on previously on previous checkpoints, and also the possibility to exploit at the application level some unused bits of data, for instance, in pointers that may permit to store some checksums for error recovery. So the full chain has been tested on a real application with a TLEAF application, for instance. So it was really a successful experiment. And it proved that it was possible, in some case, to compensate some hardware limitation at the software level. And this may be interesting in the future, as with the fading of Moore's law, we may find more and more hardware limitation as we may approach the limits of current physics. We see here another important topic. That was the constitution of power monitoring infrastructure, permitting to collect energy to solution figures and observe the main bottlenecks in this critical domain, the energy to be used at CPU level. So the work done covered the realization of a fine-grained power monitor infrastructure and the integration with standard tools such as Paravair and Slurm, to permit to correlate performance and power consumptions, and also to manage the energy consumptions of the jobs being launched. So it was a real improvement of the available tools, and this has been turned into standard versions of Slurm currently. So the next point is about the memory fault statistic and analysis. As our prototype was not error correction protected, we had to do on the software side some some checks to protect the applications. And the aim of this study was to get a complete status of the situation and see if it was possible to survive with this, and what are the lessons we can learn from this. So a simple in-house memory scanner has been developed that was able to access to all the memory of the system when the nodes are idle, to collect statistics. And this has been done during 13 months and analyze, provide a full analyze of those statistics to get some lessons from that. And the results are quite interesting. We can see that the failures are located in a very small number of cores. And therefore, a simple heuristic permitting to shut down or to take off the cores that prevent a certain level of failure, such kind of heuristic did permit to improve quite seriously the MTBF figure. So it was possible with this quarantine technique to leverage the MTBF from 2 hours to 156 hours. With only quarantining 0.5% of the total cluster resource. So it's quite interesting. Another interesting point is that we found out many errors that were not detected by the usual and simple error correction mechanism. It means, some double errors that did appear at the same time in memories, and that are not that cannot be corrected by the usual error detection or error connection mechanism. So this work was facilitated, we can say, by the limited quality of the prototype, because it was done on some with a set of technologies that is not completely suited for HPC. But the results are quite interesting, because we have to take care in the future, as we shall approach to the limits of the technology, to this kind of error. It's a little bit like the raw hammer phenomenon that can be observed also in memories. So to conclude on what could be observed with during Mont Blanc 1 and 2 phases, we did see that there is an overall need of tighter co-design between the application, the system integration, also the technology provider. Everything is linked, and we have ready to work together. The hardware architecture is really important. The node architecture is a key component, and a more balanced architecture is needed, and also a more aggressive approach to anticipate and to evaluate some more aggressive options for full exploitation of benefits. The third point is that the software needs to evolve from being latency limited to being throughput limited. To be throughput oriented. This is a real change in system and designer mentality. We really to move towards task-based models, asynchrony, overlap, communication, and computation in order to avoid being stopped when the application is waiting for data or waiting for another process result. And this has to be done with a minimum code refactoring cost. It's quite important because, of course, you know that the application development is something quite heavy, and it's not easy to do that every day. So after the past, I propose now to have a look to the present phase of the project, Mont Blanc 3. And as we with now with the fading of Moore's law, with the diminishing technology scaling that can be observed on core performance, frequency, etc., we have now to face new challenges, and we are obliged to leverage on new paradigms. For instance, how to optimize the global compute efficiency? We have to find the optimal balance for I/O, bandwidth, latency, memory, compute nodes. So we have to put all that together in the design and take that into consideration. We have to bypass the unnecessary latencies as far as possible. We have to investigate the benefit of heterogeneous architecture. We really need to go further on energy efficiency. We are far from the exascale energy target. Also, we need to assess our architecture work with some simulation. This is something quite important because, of course, simulation is complex and maybe expensive, but it's far less expensive than developing new solutions, and we really have to anticipate. We have to get prepared for massive, efficient parallelism, and also enhance the system, the software environment. And this really, here we have a convergence with what has been said previously by Riken, for instance. I think we have to push and to have the software environment more efficient. And we must always keep in mind application. The target is not to have a machine able to run the best the benchmarks at a critical speed, but we need to have a machine that is suited for real applications, and therefore we need to assess our solution with some real applications. And we need also to enhance the performance and energy monitoring tools, such as Macao by UVSQ or at system level. And global remark, we have to hide or minimize the impact of the hardware infrastructure because it's not in our minds the software developers' work to cope with the exact hardware that shall be available when his job shall be run. So now let's have a look at the objective of Mont Blanc 3. The main objective, the first one is to design a node, compute node based on ARM architecture suited for pre-exascale system. So it means really better energy efficiency. This node should be well-balanced, memory, interconnect, I/O, with the use of simulation to evaluate the options of this node on application. The second objective is to evaluate a new high-end ARM core and accelerator, evaluate the new options, and assess all the available options for compute efficiency, such as heterogeneous cores, big letters, for instance, new option for VPU, here we mean SVE, for instance, a performance core, and here again, some assessment shall be done using applications, and with one key idea, that is to prepare to transform the application from being latency limited to throughput limited. And then the third point is to go on the development of the software ecosystem that is needed for the market acceptance of the solution. So this was the target, and now the work, the current work is split in several domains. So we work on prototypes platforms that are really needed as a support for our work on the software environment running on those platforms, on the application running upon the software environment and the hardware platform. But we work also on the architecture of future nodes, potential future nodes and future systems. And we have a very strong work on simulation that is here to analyze the application's behavior and to provide some insights for the architecture work, for instance. So if we Let's have a look at the simulation work, for instance. So we evaluated the most common simulation tools available today, from GEM5 to many others based on GEM5, or also DMEMAS, SST Micro. So we did a complete analysis of these tools to do our choices and see how we can use them. So some of these tools are online, which means they are execution driven, with some code being executed. The others are offline, trace driven, with an application that is replayed from previous traces. And the scope of these evaluation tools, simulation tools, goes from the core level to the cluster level. And this is something quite important because, of course, we have to be able to look at the full scale from the node to the real cluster, and of course with some interconnects, with some memory access in the middle. So we did a kind of map of all those tools. So on this map, you can see the GEM5 tool on the bottom, and also a distant GEM5, which is a kind of GEM5 tool adapted for cluster simulation. Also, we have SimMate and Elasticsearch tools based on GEM5 that have been integrated, and now we are rather speaking on Elasticsearch SimMate. And we are approaching and we are integrating those tools with TaskSim and DMEMAS, which themselves have been put together by BSC. This is a work that has been presented at last supercomputing in November. So we did to try to do a complete map, but also integration work to be able to use the right tool at the right level, depending on the fact whether we want to have a close look at the core level or at the compute node level, at the cluster level, and to be able to zoom in or zoom out according to the target of the study being done. Yes. So I accelerate a little bit. So we do work also on the applications. The applications are key to provide inputs for the simulation and for the our architecture, but I will not say more. I skip to the next point. Software environment. This is something quite important. We try to cover the whole software stack, and we work on the most on the blocks where we have some key inputs. So we work on several parts of the whole software, and the whole software stack has been already adapted to ARM CPUs. We are contributing to OpenHPC, which is now from version 1.2, integrating the ARM CPUs. And something this is quite important for us. And ARM and Bull, for instance, are participating to OpenHPC technical work. So let's now have a look at the architecture and mini clusters. So the simulation permits us. This is a simulation run by CNRS team LIRM in Montpellier to assess our options. With a given application, we can then evaluate several options and choose the option that is the most suited, so the best combination of big cores, little cores, etc. And we try to follow three lines of effort there, with the evaluation of existing SOCs, the analysis of SVE, and the development and evaluation of semiotic combination of elements, such as big little, in order or out of order cores. So I skip this one to get, have more time for the end. So we had already seen some test platforms, and we are now developing a new test platform that is quite important for us at this current point in time, the Mont Blanc 3 test platform. It is based on Cavium ThunderX2 CPU. It is being developed by Bull, and it is integrated in Bull Sequoia architecture. It has been announced in January in Barcelona, and it is a quite important step for us. So we target here an industrial design with the integration in Bull Sequoia Island. So here, a very quick look. Sequoia Island is constituted by three cabinets, one switch cabinet in the middle, and potentially two cabinets, compute cabinets around. And each cabinet can have up to 48 blades coming into. And so we are developing now a blade with Cavium ThunderX2 CPU. So you have here a look, a view of this blade. You can see the blade itself, the cold plate that permits to have some liquid cooling arriving to the hot pieces and to permit a quite efficient liquid cooling of the CPUs. So this design, I go very quickly, but does permit a very good energy efficiency, but also a very good scalability of the solution. And this test platform, which is to be deployed in our office by the second half of this year, is quite an important step for us because it shall permit to have an integrated test bed for all the software infrastructure of the applications. It shall permit also to validate our simulation models and also to test the acceptance of our solution by some potential customers. And this is always quite interesting for us. We have to connect to users' community and to get further requirements for the next steps. Now, to conclude with a view of the future, so we have to prepare a solution that can be brought to the market. This is something important, and there we have to assess what could be missing for the end users. We have to find, of course, the right cost for that. We have to be in the right timing, and this is maybe not easy. And also, if we look at future step, we have to continue the effort on the future stack. We have to continue the work on the SOC to see how to cope with memory issues. We have to work on non-volatile, high bandwidth or 3D memories, to work on the interconnect integration, to work on the data storage movement. So the talks of this afternoon are also something that we have to take in mind for the future. I mean here about SAGE and the next-gen IO project. We have to work on accelerators for sure, and secure or SOC provisioning by reinforcing the partnership with our provider, but also by evaluating some alternative source. And if possible, it would be nice to be able to consider European sourcing. But here, certainly, we may have some funding issues. So our vision, to conclude, is that there's a need to permit a good independence between the application and the hardware levels. SVE's vector lens agnosticism is a good example for that. We need to be able to provide the programmers with the right programming paradigms. And it's a kind of a loose coupling model between the application and the hardware developments. It means that the application developer doesn't have to know for sure what shall be installed in 5 years or 10 years' time. It's not possible. But he has to program correctly, I would say, his code. And the system engineer must make everything that is possible to make this code run efficiently with available hardware. One single solution cannot fit all needs, but we have to there to have some flexible solutions that can be adapted and run most part of the application and facilitate the adaptation of the application. And then to conclude that we are cooperating in a wide environment. So we are cooperating with some European projects and stakeholders, such as the POP project, the SAGE project, for instance. Also with some non-European projects in the US with the Argonne Labs. We already had some talks with RIKEN. And for sure, we have many things to share. And I think the future is about cooperation. And then Exascale is a collective journey. We are probably just in the middle, but in our mind, Europe must take a significant part of it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.